So again, with all this background, this is what this scheme about 3-4 years back was doing, and we'll talk of what is happening to its variants in other states now. Yeah. So this scheme was called AHARA. So the first one was a ration card database, and the expectation through that database to take care of most of these concerns. Yeah. So you have biometrics. At that point, Aadhaar was not that prevalent because this started around 2010-11. So this had a biometric, so fingerprints were there. Yeah. And there was an attempt to ensure that at least these things don't happen. Yeah. So there was a physical verification. You had to go and enroll yourself in the photo bio centers, which were set up in every ward in urban areas and in panchayats in rural areas. So households or family members had to go there, get their fingerprints captured. Yeah. So there was one attempt of trying to weed out all those bogus duplicate ghost cards. Yeah. Bogus to a certain extent, suspect through this, because that process does not account for APL, BPL. It only says that, oh, there is a physical person who is attached to this ration card. Yeah. But there was some attempt, because there was a lot of hue and cry at that point around 2012-13. The total number of households in Karnataka was about 1.2 crores. Yeah. The population was around 6 crores. And the total number of ration cards was about 1.8 crores. Yeah. So when you get into that state, obviously there's something that's not happening properly. Yeah. So because of that, we went into all that stuff, and a lot of ration cards, bogus, ghost, were weeded out. Yeah. So almost 50-60 lakh ration cards got eliminated in this process. So we came down from about 1.6, 1.7 crores to about 1 crore or say 90 lakh. Still on the higher side, if you consider the planning commission at that point in time, their poverty statistics, because they said that BPL households in Karnataka should be around 30%, not more than that. But then the state had a certain, a more accommodative policy of identifying BPL households for ration cards, and therefore the numbers could have been slightly higher. Yeah. So this AHARA, this ration card database, which was biometric, which used fingerprints, was designed to ensure a lot of inclusion errors are taken care of. Yeah. The way this was designed did not do a lot to the exclusion error. The second component, and this was done pretty well. Yeah, so there was a statewide campaign and a lot of effort, a lot of buy-in from the political establishment using the CM. Yeah, all of that went into a lot of media coverage. Yeah, into ensuring that the ration card database of eligible households was cleaned up. Yeah. The second one was a financial and stock accounting system. This was to ensure that leakages during the supply chain, they are taken care of. Yeah. So this was this had to register the amount of food grains received at all the authorized wholesale points and those lifted by the ration dealers every month. This did not this was not done as extensively as the first one. Yeah. This was more or less, this covered the entire state. All the beneficiaries after a particular point in time were denied from ration shops if they did not have a biometric enabled card at that point in time. Yeah. And the case that Professor Shrisha Rao was talking about, Jharkhand, is an instance of a similar case. There it's Aadhaar enabled, but beyond a particular time, there were households that were denied ration if they did not have a card which was biometric, which had a biometric data embedded into it. And the third one was, you invoked that biometric database to provide food grains at the front end. So at the ration shops, as a, when I went to claim my ration and I gave my ration card number and my authentication through a fingerprint of one of the household members, it said, oh, you are entitled for this much and this is what you are going to get. Yeah, and there were these kinds of devices that were kept. I think in a few districts, about 5 districts, it was pretty widespread, but then it kind of petered out after some time. So this is an electronic weighing machine. Yeah, so it weighs, and this is also a POS kind of device. So this is where you enter the say the card details and the kind of authenticate through your fingerprint, and it says, oh, you are entitled for so much, and it also speaks out. Yeah, so for those who are not able to read or those who cannot see what's written there, it speaks out saying that this is the household, you are entitled for so much. And when the weight was taken, it would also announce that, oh, the weight is 20 kgs and it is 20 kgs rice. Yeah, and then this had to be given to the kind of the household there. So this was done pretty seriously. This was enforced pretty seriously in a few contexts. It did not work for various reasons 100% of the time, because of issues with fingerprint, because of issues with connectivity, because of various other aspects. Yeah, and not only related to the technology, but also related to the other, say, other incentives and disincentives that are embedded in a system design like this. Yeah? Now, what has happened? So this is what the design looks like. Yeah, and this is Karnataka about 2-3 years back. If you look at, if some of you have followed the debates around Aadhaar and PDS, what is it that you have? Anyone has been following those discussions? What kind of designs are coming out in terms of PDS and Aadhaar? The claims are that Aadhaar is going to take care of all the problems in PDS. Yeah? So if you happen to go and see the Aadhaar, the initial Aadhaar, say, papers, there are two things that it says. Yeah? It says PDS and NREGA, the Rural Employment Guarantee Act. That scheme. There are a lot of leakages in these two schemes. Yeah, that's a drain on the state exchequer, and through a robust way of digital identification, we'll take care of, I don't think they say all, but the sense that you get by reading those 2-3 page documents, which were very strong in terms of, which were used to make a legitimate case for pumping in a lot of public money into a scheme like Aadhaar. The premise was that it will pay for itself by plugging in the problems that schemes like PDS and NREGA have. Yeah? So, yeah, sorry. Anyone following that debate, what is happening? How is Aadhaar being used in PDS? Largely this. Yeah, so this is what they are trying to do. 1 and 3, not this. 1 and 3, and this is what happened here also. Yeah, it started with 1, 2, and 3. Yeah, the focus on 1 and 3 remained. This lost out. Yeah, while this was a part of the original design, nothing much happened with 2. Yeah, most of the focus was on 1 and 3. Yeah, ensuring that the database is weeded out of inclusion errors, yeah, and ensuring that at the front end, when you have to say give those grains, there is a proper authentication that is carried out. Yeah, so in terms of PDS and digital technologies, more or less most of the states are moving towards a similar design. What they've done is replaced a local database in this case with a authentication database provided by Aadhaar. Yeah. Now, given that, what do you feel happens to all those issues, and what do you feel happens to this? So the technology that's right now, see, these are the concerns with PDS. Yeah, these are the concerns with PDS as we some of the concerns with PDS. The technology design in case of Karnataka, the Ahara project was like this. Yeah, there were three important elements. One was to ensure that you had a database which was weeded out of bogus duplicate entries. Yeah, and you used that when you were releasing the food grains to the beneficiaries. So that's on the user side. Yeah, where is it largely concerned with? Here, this interface. Yeah, at the last mile. Yeah, this one, two, is also concerned with. Yeah, it's not only concerned with this, it's concerned right from 1 to 3 all. Yeah, so given this and given where we are in terms of use of Aadhaar in PDS, what do you think the state sees as a big concern in terms of a scheme like PDS? The state sees these two as the biggest concern. Yeah, the state does not see those as concerns or those as bigger concerns, at least in terms of its choice of technology design. Yeah, when it says that we are going to ensure that the problems of PDS will be plugged, it feels that this is where the problems are. Yeah, it does not feel that problems could exist elsewhere. Yeah, and some of those problems need not only be at this level. Yeah, unless you are able to, may not be under this person's control all the time. Yeah, if this person gets a poor quality grain from the higher godowns, how can he or she leverage digital technologies to question the Food Corporation of India that the grain that you are giving to me is not good?
Sir, like what about the question of quantity which is coming? Like, because there should be a concern right from the supplier side. FSA should be concerned about the how much it should supply. Probably there can be a time when they don't have the enough supplies and they know, like the requirement is this much and they don't have.
Fortunately, that's not the case. They are flooded with supplies. So we have still not reached a position where the FCI godowns have run out of food grains.
And is it safe to say, like at a more general level, that the state is much more preoccupied and concerned with inclusion errors than exclusion errors in terms of its own, where
it
spends energy, invests in technology and so on?
Yes, that's what I also feel. Yeah, that's what I also feel. That what it is, so given this, what it tells us about not the state, not only the state, but also the way technologies are being invoked in a program like this is, it's still too humanitarian and welfare focused. Yeah, and yes.
Do these technologies also aim to root out the problem faced by exclusion error where eligible households are left out? I mean, so all these schemes, while they target the inclusion errors mainly, they also in a way cover the problem of exclusion error when we say that eligible households are left out.
That's being done through Adam Smith's invisible hand. Yeah. How is it being done? The argument that's being invoked is that if you have lesser inclusion errors, you will have more food grains to be supplied to those who need it.
But like you said, supply is not an issue.
So right now, there is no evidence to suggest that we are running short on supplies. But this is the argument that's invoked. Yeah? to say that we should focus on inclusion errors, because if we are able to weed out, say, 20% of the ineligible ration cards, and assuming that the food grains are getting into those 20% households, we'll at least open up space for 20% more eligible households to partake of or participate in this scheme. Yeah. So what I'm trying to come to is that the design logic, yeah, or the governance logic that is being invoked in a technology design like this, yeah, is, yes, inclusion errors to ensure that these inefficiencies at this level are taken care of without a lot of inefficiencies at higher levels of the state machinery being considered. One is the higher levels of the state is not considered inefficient. So when you say the state is inefficient, the state at the lower levels is inefficient. Yeah, it's not the minister sitting in Delhi, it's not the secretary sitting in Delhi, it's not anyone in Bangalore. Yeah, the village in Tumkur, the Fair Price shop owner in Tumkur, the people who live in Tumkur, they are corrupt, they are inefficient, they engage in unethical behavior. Yeah, so that's what this perspective of technology design is trying to propagate. Yeah.
I just want to add one thing, it just came into my mind. So what happened when the food security bill was came into the parliament, one argument was also that the FCA was not having the details how much food grain they have on the real time basis. So it was also from this.
Yes, correct. Yeah. And therefore you need that. Yeah, therefore you need. So who was concerned? FCI. Did anyone ask them anything? Yeah, when this was designed, who were consulted? Them. Yeah, the secretary sitting in Delhi. Yeah, in many cases, they were not consulted, and the design came out in a manner as it has. And it is, and because of certain, or because of the logic embedded into that kind of design, it can do certain things, it can probably not do a few things. Yeah? Okay. Yes.
Do we fill in that structure? FCI owns this dealer, then second person part, then fourth, then goes to beneficiary.
We may not.
In the future, we may form FCI directly centralized system.
We may not. Or why do we need FCI at all? Yeah, at that level, why do we need the wheat grown in Punjab to be consumed by a household in Mandya who has never seen wheat in his or her life? Yeah, they have consumed ragi, they have consumed something else. Why should the excess wheat of Punjab or some of the northern states be pushed to change the entire food behavior of a context, of a household in say Karnataka or Kerala or Andhra Pradesh? Yeah. So again, that's another area of concern that we should look at. Again, that is something that's a exclusion error. I don't eat wheat, and you are trying to give me wheat. What will I do with that wheat? So that's another error which is not on the radar of the state at this point in time. To a certain extent it is, because say certain states like Karnataka have started say incorporating ragi and jowar and some of these minor millets into the say PDS system. Yeah, so but at say national level, this is not a big concern, and therefore our choice of technology does not have anything to do with this. Yeah, if we had these things, yeah, if we had these as greater concerns, we may not need UID. Yeah, UID has, if you go through the initial documents, the legitimacy of UID comes from PDS and NREGA. Yes. Yeah, and this is what it is doing to PDS and NREGA. It's looking at this to a certain extent. If these are concerns, and if these are concerns of an equally important magnitude, you don't need a technology design like a universal identity. That's not too big a concern.
Sir, biometric control of transactions, the third part, isn't this, I mean, the machine that you talked about, is it the same across, wherever this is being implemented, is it the same? Not just in Karnataka, but it's just, let's say, Jharkhand.
The specifications would be same. Yeah.
Okay. No, but because if the authentication process is divorced from, the metric which indicates quantity and others, then the pilferage can still happen.
Yes. So it's not like this. So interestingly, in Karnataka, this is what they started with. Yeah. Then they did away with this. They removed this. They said, we'll do the authentication and we'll do the weighing separately. We'll not link both of them. Yeah. So there are certain, you'd probably be able to figure out who are the kind of people who would benefit from something like this. Yeah. But I think what my takeaway from this example is that there is a scheme, yeah, the scheme that the government formulates with certain, say, governance objectives in mind. Yeah. When it comes to designing technologies, we can exercise a choice. There is nothing very deterministic in the way technology can be designed or should be designed. Yeah. As designers of technology or as designers of any of these government programs, there is a lot of choice that is exercised. Yeah. So that is one of the takeaways. And then let's move on, and then we can come back to this discussion. So at a, say, outcome impact level, if you look at malnutrition, if you look at hunger, not much difference there. The second project this is slightly dated kind of fieldwork, but I'll still talk about this. This is agricultural land records. Yeah. There's a project which was done in Karnataka in the late 90s, and again, this derived from a national mandate on reforming land records across the country. It was done simultaneously in a few states. Karnataka was the pioneer. This is a much awarded project, not only in India, but across the world, not only UN, even World Bank. So all sorts of organizations that are significant in the world today have looked at this and feel that this is a good way of using technology in governance. Yeah. So what does this do? Are you aware of land records? Anyone has engaged or any direct contact with agriculture, farming? None of you. Okay, so what happens in a lot of, say, rural areas, there is you have records for the land that you own. And these, the way farming happens, it requires credit, yeah, for farmers, because a lot of investment needs to be sunk in right towards the beginning of the sowing period, and you start getting returns only after 4 to 6 months, once you have harvested the crop and you have sold it in the market. Yeah. And then you have to rely on that short-term 6-month credit for your working capital. Yeah. Now, for the smaller farmers, and most of the agricultural land holdings in India are with small and marginal farmers. So small farmers are those who have land holding of less than 2 hectares. 2 hectares, marginal have less than 1 hectare. So almost 3/4 of the agricultural land in the country is, or maybe more, is held by small and marginal farmers. Most of the small and marginal farmers, they are also low income households. Yeah, so they don't have a surplus which they can invoke for their working capital during farming. Yeah, so they depend on credit. And they for carrying out their farming activities. Now, this is a record, this record of rights tenancy crops, which says, which gives a snapshot of their land parcel. It says, oh, this is the extent of land, this is irrigated by this canal, or this has a borewell, and this is the kind of irrigation facilities available. These are the crops that have been grown, that are being grown in this land. This is the kind of yields that have happened. And these are the liens on this land. So this farmer has taken a loan by mortgaging this land of this amount. So it more or less carries a snapshot. And in case of India, RBI, NABARD, and the government, what they say is for small magnitude crop loans up to 50,000 now, having a RTC should be enough. Yeah, you don't need a collateral. The farmer need not mortgage the land. Yeah, having a valid RTC without any encumbrances, yeah, should be good enough for a farmer to access formal sector credit. Yeah. So this is what this. So this project is trying to. So there, the assumption behind the project design was that the way in which these records were maintained earlier, it was done at the in every village. There is a person called village accountant who is in the revenue administration, the closest to the farming households. Yeah. The village accountant would maintain the record of this rights, tenancy, and crops in his or her register. It was mainly his register. And whenever a farmer required an extract of that record, the farmer would go to the village accountant, and the village accountant would, on a piece of paper, give all those details. And then that document is what the farmer would take to a bank. Yeah. To access any credit that the bank had to provide. Now you could see that there's so many village accountants, yeah, across the country. There could be so many different ways in which they would maintain their records, and they would put it on a piece of paper. Yeah. So it was not a uniform piece of paper that you had all these fields written in this way, in this font, with this spacing, all that. Yeah. So different village accountants, depending on what was the practice in their area, would provide these records in different ways. Yeah. Sometimes it was also difficult to ascertain whether the record has been provided by a valid village accountant or not. Yeah. Because you may not have a stamp, you would not know that, oh, this is the village accountant, because there was no registry to say, this is the village accountant, this is his or her signature, and therefore this is how you can match that. Yeah. So because of that, and then the other assumption was that the village accountants would engage in extortionary practices when farmers approached them for this extract. Yeah. So in many cases, they were assumed not to be present in the village, difficult to access by the farmers, yeah, and I'm saying assumed with an underline, yeah, difficult to access by the farmers, yeah, and whenever the farmer had to get an extract, he or she would have to pay something extra to the village accountant to get that extract. Yeah. So at one level, there was this this corruption charge on the village accountant, the extortion, that the rent-seeking behavior that the village accountant was expected to engage in, because he had to constantly interact with the farmers. Yeah. On the other hand, the banks had an issue in terms of validating whether the extract has come from an authentic source or not. Yeah. So these were largely the concerns that at that point in time, the state felt, and the various agencies of the state felt, was restricting formal credit going into the agricultural sector. Going into the agricultural sector, which was of relevance to the small and marginal farmers. Yeah? Because most of the small and marginal farmers would not take, say, loans for buying a tractor. Yeah? They would take crop loans, yeah, which was less than 50,000. And at that point in time, it was believed that because of this, you still have a lot of money lenders in practice, and money lenders charge usurious, say, interest rates, 36% per annum, etc., and that leads to further distress for the farmers. So there was a welfare livelihood kind of logic that was invoked. There was another thing of leakages, corruption being engaged by the village accountant, yeah, being invoked. And with all that, this was attempted, that what we'll do is we'll computerize all these land records. Yeah. So there are some 20 fields, 25 fields. Again, what was not considered was that land records have a strong historical linkage. In India, in Karnataka, for example, there are different areas and which have followed different types of land administration systems. For example, the old Mysore state, yeah, the part where we are all in, went into a peasant-based record system pretty early. Yeah, during the Wadiyars, it went into a record system where peasants were given, where the cultivators, the rayats were given their land records. The Hyderabad, Karnataka area, the Raichur, the Koppals, yeah, there the zamindari system continued for a long time. For a long time, it was tenant cultivation that was practiced. Yeah. So I own land, but I would get it cultivated by a tenant, because land ownership was concentrated in a few castes. Yeah. In the old Mysore state, and that has been across the country, land ownership is not only did not only have economic kind of basis. It was a indicator of your social status. Yeah? So unless you were a Brahmin or unless you were one of those castes, you could not own land. Yeah, but if you were of that caste, you would definitely not do physical work. Yeah, so you had to engage someone to do that work. So a lot of tenant cultivation was practiced, continued to practice. In the Hyderabad, Karnataka region. In the old Mysore state, the ownership of land passed on to the tenants pretty early. Yeah, so there are different variants in the way land administration has been practiced in different parts of the state in the country. Because of that, what is a valid record, or what is it that should go into something like a RTC, was different in different regions. Yeah, so they were at that time. Someone figured out that there was more than 500, 600 different formats in which RTCs were being produced. Yeah, and some of it had genuine linkages with the kind of land administration system that existed. Now, all of that one was rationalized into one set. Yeah. So from a 500 format, if you have to get into one format, you have to exercise choice. Yeah. What could be some of the drivers of that choice? Again, your power relations. So if you are more powerful, yeah, you will ensure that the fields that matter more to you get into that format. So again, that's a political exercise going on at the time of that database design itself. Yeah. So that happened. So this project, what it tried to do was try to rationalize all those 500 formats into one, yeah, and then said that, okay, now we will have a uniform database. These are the 20 fields or 25 fields that we'll capture, that we'll consider are valid. Yeah. And then what we will do is we'll remove the village accountants from the entire chain, because they are the most corrupt. And what we'll do is we'll push this to this. So we'll remove the village accountant, we'll replace the village accountant by a computer which is sitting in the taluk headquarters, operated by a data entry operator. Once you have all that record, you can go apply for a RTC, and then you stand in a line and get an RTC without anyone exerting unnecessary influence on you and anyone seeking rent out of you. Yeah? So that is what this project was about. And again, something like this has been is being replicated across the country. So agricultural land records with the motive of enabling more and more formal sector credit is being computerized. Yeah, digital technologies are being used there, and the design logic that is being invoked is just as in the case of the fair price shop owners, the inefficiency lies at the grassroots. The village accountants are to be removed from the process or to be monitored, and therefore we will bring in digital technologies to replace or substitute for the village accountants. Now, these are the two places that my findings are, and this is what I was referring to. I'll not get into a lot of details. Maybe I'll refer you to the paper here. You can look at that. But broadly, the findings are that because of a design like that, the gains, and this is only in two districts of Karnataka that I have studied, the gains were not uniform. Yeah, because the people who are using it, they come with different, say, capacities, endowments, all that. So at least what I found, I conducted some 200 odd interviews across 20 villages in both these districts. And what I found was that the bigger farmers in Mandya and irrigated areas of Koppal, yeah, Koppal is a rather dry area, Mandya is a more irrigated area, it's just downstream of this, of the KRS dam. Yeah. So the bigger farmers in Mandya and the bigger farmers in irrigated areas of Koppal, they gained. So they were better off after the computerization than they were before. The bigger farmers in dry areas of Koppal, the smaller farmers in irrigated areas of Mandya. Yeah? So these were the three groups broadly which I found gained or had a positive difference to their incomes and to the way they were interacting with the state and farmer credit organizations. Who did not gain? The tenant farmers in Koppal. Yeah? Though tenancy is illegal, it's still practiced in a widespread manner in a place like Koppal. So they did not gain. The smaller farmers in dry areas of Koppal and Mandya did not gain. Yeah? And then, to put that into perspective, less than 40% of the total sown area is irrigated in Mandya. Yeah? For Koppal, it is less than 25%. For Karnataka, this figure is around 20%. That's roughly what it is for India, not a lot of difference. So Karnataka that way is a median state. Yeah? The small and marginal holdings constituted about 3/4 of the entire thing. Yeah? So that is what that design had as implications on some of these groups. I'll go a bit fast. We can come back to this if you want to. Yeah. The third one, and I'll cover this quickly, is the property registration project that Madam was talking about. Yeah. So again, this is something that has been going on in Karnataka for the last 15 years. Yeah. But you have similar variants in Maharashtra, in Andhra Pradesh, and various other states that are trying to emulate something like this. Yeah. What happens is whenever there is a transaction of property, yeah, immovable property, and you want a legal sanction or you want that transaction to be considered in a court of law at a later date, you have to get it registered in one of these sub-registrar offices of the state. And by doing that, the state, what is the state saying? The state is saying that I am witness to this transaction. That's the only thing that the state says when you go and get your, say, transaction document registered. And because the state is witness to that transaction, in a court of law, if there is any dispute that occurs because of that transaction, you can produce that document. Yeah. In fact, a lot of other documents also need to be registered. Marriage documents marriage has to be registered, will has to be registered, inheritance, all of that has to be registered. And the state bears witness. It does not guarantee anything. It does not comment on what is inside that agreement. That is between the transacting parties. So the onus of when you engage into a say immovable property registration, the onus of finding the legality of the transaction is on the buyers and the sellers. The state does not bear witness or does not guarantee that. In India, we have a system of land titling or property titling which is inconclusive. Yeah, it is. So the state does not say, so even if I own a piece of land, it is a presumptive titling. So it's not conclusive. So none of our properties are conclusive titles. Yeah, the state has not said that, yes, you are the owner of this piece of land. What does the state say? I am witness to this transaction between you as a buyer and you as a seller. In a different context, what does the state say? I am providing this water service or this electricity service to your property, and for that I am collecting tax. I am providing civic facilities to this area, and for that I am collecting tax from you as residing in that property. So in none of our state transactions which deal with property, the state says that you are the owner of this property.